Do I look, do me and Miz look taller than Jay? Jay?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll slouch. I'll slouch, Jay.
Maybe you should just stand.
What is up, WWE Universe? Kathy Kelly here, joined by an incredible group of WWE superstars. Today, we are celebrating the 40-year history of the Intercontinental Championship. And who better to celebrate that workhorse championship with than Randy Orton, Christian, and The Miz, three men who have held that title and brought back prestige to the IC title. So just overview of the championship. What does it mean for you specifically?
It's kind of what got the ball rolling with my career.
Yeah.
I knew, I believe it was in 2003. It was Rob Van Dam. I think it was December of 2003 at a pay-per-view. I beat Rob, got the IC title around my waist, and it was like, okay, here we go. Now I know that I'm here and I can hang with the big
one. I mean, really propelled your career, because even though the WWE Universe was definitely behind you at that time, it kick-started everything for you.
Yeah, 100%. And I think that's kind of how it goes, you know, when you got somebody that you know is going to be something in this business, the powers that be, they kind of look to push towards the IC title and then give him a chance to, you know, show what he can do.
Yeah, and so many superstars started their careers with an Intercontinental Championship reign. You, sir, have held it several times.
Yeah.
But what does it mean for you as well?
Well, first of all, when you said brought prestige back to the Intercontinental Championship and you pointed to The Miz, I almost threw my breakfast up. just gonna say that right now.
I noticed that too.
But the
I mean, he does have a win over you for that.
I'm sure.
My first win.
I know.
It was my first Intercontinental title win was against this guy.
Yeah, so for me, growing up a huge WWE fan, I was drawn to the Intercontinental Championship, the look of it, the aesthetics of it, and the superstars that held it. Mm-hmm. You know, my earliest memories are of Macho Man, Randy Savage having it, the Honky Tonk Man, Tito Santana beating Greg the Hammer Valentine for it, and Valentine destroying the Intercontinental Championship and then bringing that kind of newer design to it.
Well, speaking of newer designs, this is, I don't think anyone's ever actually seen this, but this was held by Tito Santana back in the day.
Right, and then
in the 80s, I believe.
Yeah, so for me, it was an attainable thing. Like, my goal was to be a wrestler, to be a WWE superstar. That's what I wanted. And when I looked at superstars that were Intercontinental champions, they were, I felt like I could be their size. You didn't have to be, like at that time, the world heavyweight champion, whoever held that title seemed to be a huge presence, and I knew that I would never be that big, so for
you're
me-
pretty big presence, Jay.
I meant physically.
I think you're big physically.
Yeah, physically you're big.
So in Toronto at the old Maple Leaf Gardens, Edge and I, we used to get this, the same tickets every time we went to a show, and it was right along the aisleway. And I'll never forget the Texas Tornado, Kerry Von Erich, came out, he was the Intercontinental Champion, and he saw us there, you know, cheering him on, and he came over and he held the Intercontinental Championship over the rail in front of us, and we actually had our hands on it touched it. And we looked at each other, and we're like, oh, we just touched the Intercontinental Championship. Like, and then years later, to go on and become an Intercontinental Champion and to beat Edge for my first Intercontinental Championship,
you know,
it meant
a
lot. And to me, growing up, it seemed to me that that was the guy that was preparing to take the next step. Mm. That, and for me to get that, that it felt like I was on my way to becoming bigger and taking further steps that I needed in my career. And the Intercontinental Championship was the starting point for that.
Yeah, I mean, when you talk about legends and WWE Hall of Famers, that was the first stop in their career. You look back at incredible Intercontinental Champions like Pedro Morales.
I feel like now it's not like that anymore. Like, I feel like the Intercontinental title isn't the stepping stone to the WWE Championship.
Yeah.
Would you guys agree, or?
I do agree, and I think it's also because, you know, we have, you know, there's a champion like Brock Lesnar who, he's not there all the time, and you know, there's no other superstar like Brock, and for me, he is, you know, a special performer, and to put him out there every week makes him more regular, if that makes any sense. You know what I mean? So you can't do that with him. So for me, when you have live events and you have tours and all these other things, the Intercontinental Championship needs to have that importance that you can put it on in a main event situation.
Sure.
And it means something to the fans that are there watching.
Yeah. Well, Miz, I look at you and I feel like my brain goes towards the Intercontinental Championship because of the successful title reigns that you've had, but that was actually the last championship that you needed to fulfill the Grand Slam and Triple Crown.
Actually, it was, I beat him for it.
How many times did you hold the IC title?
Eight, yeah.
Eight now? Okay, yeah. I was up there.
Second most, Intercontinental Championship reigns. And also, I don't know if you know this, but combined days, you are the second most behind Pedro Morales.
Oh, wow.
For holding the title.
How far am I away? Do you know that?
About 20 days.
You're an encyclopedia. Look at you. You know, it's funny, on my first win for the Intercontinental title, I believe it was Raw 500?
It was Raw 1000.
Raw 1000, that was it. And I got a call, or I got a text from Edge telling me that was the best match I've ever seen you in.
Oh.
And this guy.
That effect on people. What can I say, guys?
That is true.
Yeah, he does. That is 100%.
We could do a whole one of these on how awesome he is to work with. Yeah.
You're going to make me blush, Randy.
But yeah, it was incredible to get that title. Just like kind of he was saying, when I was a kid growing up, my favorite was Ultimate Warrior. I just loved his energy. Like when I was a child, you know, a guy that paints his face just muscular and just had this ball of energy, that I just loved it. Three clotheslines, he was done, you know? In a splash, that was it. And I just remember him with the title, every color that he had, basically he had a different color for the IC title. And so being able to hold that title that kind of the people I watched growing up held, it was an honor, it was a privilege, and it was amazing. And I was in a time where it kind of, through the years, it started going down where anytime a person had the IC title, they would be on a show and they would be the person that would lose all the time with the title. And it was just like, oh, he has the title. He'll just lose today. And I was sick of that mentality because that title meant so much to me when I was a kid growing up. And it kept getting thrown away. So I just came to a point where I'll never forget, I got drafted to SmackDown and they wouldn't put me on the show. Like I was the Intercontinental Champion. And I couldn't get on the show. Mm-hmm. And they were debuting new SmackDown titles and new, I believe it was a new women's title. And the one title that I thought was prestigious and had such a rich history was being forgotten. And that's how the infamous Talking Smack came, where I just went off on Daniel Bryan.
Yeah.
Because I just, all my frustrations that I had with this title and being the superstar that I am, I just unleashed on Daniel.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it wasn't just words. You wanted to actually make the championship mean something again, make it must-see.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So looking back, since you guys all grew up watching this title get defended and people challenge for this championship, were there matches specifically that stood out to you that made you want to become a WWE superstar?
Well, I think the one off the top of my head and probably on a lot of top of a lot of people's list, it would be Ricky Steamboat against Randy Savage at WrestleMania 3. I mean, I think that's the kind of benchmark for Intercontinental Championship matches. I know growing up that match solidified that I wanted to have that title at some point. To go out and put a classic match on that's still talked about to this day shows you the importance of the Intercontinental Championship.
It's funny, I watched, believe it or not, you versus Edge for the IC title. It was the main event, and it was like a two-seg match, really long match, but it told this amazing story. And so growing up, people would always say, watch these matches that you want to be, that you want to emulate, if you will.
Yeah.
And so I would always watch his, Edge, him, a lot of superstars that people were known for being very good in the ring. And this was like a match with you and Edge where it was kind of your comeuppance. Like you guys weren't at you were at the world titles, but it was like you guys were coming up together.
Yeah, that was as probably the top 2003
stars.
Or
yeah,
early
something
2004.
Along those lines.
Yeah.
And it was just, it was one of those matches that you watch and you go, oh wow, okay, these guys are putting on a clinic. And it was two new up and comers that you were like, ooh, you want to see what they can do.
Yeah.
And then not only do they do it, but they exceed expectations.
When it goes back to what you were saying about the IC champ being able to close the show out, you know, and it being that important, and then, you know, how it has kind of lost that, you know, as of late, and how we need to get it back, there once again. But Don Morocco and my dad tagged together back in WWE. And I know Don was the Intercontinental Championship. And I remember just the fact that Don Morocco would always be over at my house. I always thought it was cool that I had a champ in the house.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's a memory that sticks out for me.
Yeah. Well, even though you only held the championship once, you held it for over 200 days and had an incredible feud with Mick Foley during that time. Yeah. Someone who actually never held the Intercontinental title.
Right, right. Wow, yeah. I did work with Mick then.
Yeah, I know. That's it insane. All blurs together.
No, it really does. And like some guys, like
that the tax in your back? Was that him?
So, yeah.
No, that was with Mick.
That was with Mick, because that's one of my, like, that's kind of the match that I think the fans started taking me seriously, because just what Mick and I put each other's bodies through, and Mick's the best.
Well, it's about credibility too, right? And when you beat a guy that has the equity in his, so to speak,
his career. And that's what it's all about.
You know, yeah, that gave you another level of credibility after you beat a legend like Mick Foley.
100%. And I was the legend killer, so it's like, if you're going to call yourself the legend killer and actually kill some legends, you know, that's exactly like you just said. You know, that helps me. That's like a stepping stone. That helps me be taken seriously. You know, I was a boy. I turned into a man when I was able to take Mick and, you know, make him bleed and sweat and wince, and it was, he did the same to me, and it was that was one of my favorite matches, and I completely forgot that it was back when I was the IC champ. So that's actually pretty funny.
Yeah, I think that was like late 2003, early 2004.
Yep, it would have been, sure, yeah.
And you know, just talking about credibility as well, that's something I felt that I was always fighting for my entire career.
Yeah.
Right up to the end, I was always fighting for credibility, and two major times that happened to me were the first time I beat Edge for the Intercontinental Championship. He had, you know, was projected to be this big star, so for me to beat him for that gave me instant credibility. And then the second time was with Randy when he and I were feuding for the World Heavyweight Championship, having a series of matches. Those, to me, were the biggest moments as far as credibility goes in my career.
That's incredible.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Well, talking about prestige as well, when you two had your first Intercontinental Championship win, when you faced Christian for that title.
I was sick that day. Yeah. And I had something in my eye.
Well,
and I had a twisted ankle and a broken fibula.
You did have the broken fibula, I remember that.
Yeah. Were you also a little thrown off when Bret Hart came out to announce it and talked about the prestige of that championship?
A little bit.
Yeah. But to have someone who has that history, a WWE Hall of Famer, come out and set the stage for you guys, what does that mean for you?
Well, I mean, he's Bret Hart.
You know?
He's you know, whenever you say the best of something, it's subjective. Mm-hmm. But he's definitely, in my mind, top five of all time.
Yeah.
And definitely same thing as far as the Intercontinental Championship goes. So for him, for me, also a guy from Canada, I grew up idolizing him, being from the same country, to come out, that's huge. And like you said, you know, gives it an extra special feeling that we were about to do something pretty amazing.
Yeah, it's funny because I've gotten to work with Bret Hart, like when no one else really has gotten the opportunity. Now, granted, it wasn't for the IC title, it's for the United States. I've actually gotten to lose the United States Championship to Bret the Hitman Hart.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget, in Toronto, mind you, which was just an absolute eruption because of the whole screw job and everything that happened, him winning the United States title against me, it was the loudest reaction that you could possibly want for a situation. And for a guy like me, you know, that was just, you know, bad guy that was always getting booed, and then to hear an audience cheer when you lose, it's like the best thing as a heel.
Sure.
Like there's nothing better than to hear an audience just erupt for someone else winning the title that isn't you. I mean, that's just the glee that I get whenever I'm a heel or a bad guy.
Yeah, you're doing your job.
Exactly.
Well,
Well, you can really speak to gaining the respect over years from the WWE universe.
Still trying, still working for it.
I genuinely think you have, though, and like your legacy with the Intercontinental Championship, especially like when I was doing research for this, every single website, when I was looking at the list of greatest Intercontinental Champions, it would have like Pedro Morales, The Miz. Like,
really?
It would list, yeah.
That's
so
crazy to me.
To think that that could potentially be your legacy.
It's funny, as cocky, arrogant, and egotistical as I give myself off to WWE, I still don't believe that. Like, yeah. I always feel like, and I think a lot of superstars feel this way, like you're always working. You're always trying to be better and trying to get the respect that you feel like you don't have.
Yeah, but isn't that the symbolism behind the Intercontinental Championship?
Yeah, you might think so. You might think like if you look up a list and see all these different names, and it does touch me. It goes, oh, wow, that's amazing. But still, I have this fighting spirit that makes me go, I need to do more. I need to do better. I need to be bigger. I need to be better. I want more respect. It's just some mentality, something wrong with my brain. I don't know. I don't know if it's everyone that gets that.
I think everyone's kind of wired that way. And I'll say for you, the first time when I saw Miz, you know, kind of coming into the company, and I saw him backstage, and you know, just, you know, he's a
lot to take in.
A lot to take in. You know, sometimes better in small doses, right? Mm-hmm. But I honestly, and I've told him this in the past, I looked at him and said, this guy won't even last a year here. And he was coming from reality TV, so he had that stigma about him. Mm-hmm. Had done some training as far as wrestling goes, but wasn't, you know, there yet as far as the in-ring ability goes. But sometimes, you know, somebody with a strong personality, that can overshadow what they do in the ring because their personality is so strong. And it goes the other way too for people that are really, you know, well-known to be, you know, these amazing wrestlers. Sometimes that can overshadow the personality part. It works both ways. But for him, I think he's really underrated as far as how good he is and how good he's gotten in the ring. And for me, I've never seen anybody work harder than him to get better at this craft and to be taken seriously. So to have, you know, right there on the cusp of having the most Intercontinental Championships in history, I mean, it's a testament to the hard work he's put in. And I'm a fan, and I think he's really underrated, and I think he's really underrated in the ring. I think he's really talented in the ring.
And you got to remember, you were in your early 20s.
Yeah.
So you were in the back. I feel like we were all.
But I feel like, when you're in your early 20s, you're just a ball of fire, and you want to, you know.
You want to prove people wrong. You want to.
You know, it rubs off on some people the wrong way. And I can relate. But we, like, you know, I'll be 40 next year. Half my life, I've worked for this company, and so I've grown up around guys like you. You're one of the guys that's been around as. Just about as long as me. I feel like, you know, you got Ziggler, you, me, you know, guys that are still out there.
Still there,
You know, it's that list is dwindling down. But, like, I remember what he's talking about. I remember, like, Drunk Miz, you know, on the overseas tours.
Oh,
and I can't, you know, this guy, but like to see where you've come and what you're doing outside of the ring, and you know, you're a father now, and you know, it's cool to see what you've become. Mm-hmm. So I agree with Jay with that. That's really cool.
Well, after holding it 8 times, was there a specific reign that stands out most to you?
The first and the last. First, because it was the first time I ever had it. I had a great match with Christian, and it was incredible to hold that title for the first time. You know, it just all these memories came rushing back. And then the last time, because it was one of those things that I really did feel that it was pushed down in the dirt, and we rose it to where it was main eventing live events, it was main eventing SmackDown, Raw, whatever show that I was on, it was main eventing. And it was the talk of the thing, because like you said, the Universal Champion wasn't there.
Yeah.
But the Intercontinental title was there every single night. And that's kind of the whole name of the Intercontinental. It's the workhorse title. Mm-hmm. It's the title with the hardest worker in the company. And I think it should still be that way. So that's kind of, that's why I always say the first and the last were the most important.
Yeah. Do you think that you would have been able to bring as many eyeballs and have the WWE Universe as much on the journey that you were going through if you didn't have an outlet like a Talking Smack?
I think Talking Smack really helped it out.
Yeah.
100%. It was a show that they needed a little oomph, I guess you can say. And I feel like that promo gave it the oomph it needed. Mm-hmm. I got a lot of texts from a lot of people that was just like, holy cow, you went off. And honestly, I look back at that promo and I honestly look at it and go, oh wow, that wasn't that good. Like I was stuttering, I was my mind was-
It was real though. Yeah. And I remember like, oh, this went off.
Yeah.
Like that was good stuff, dude.
Yeah, but
the emotion, like I'm not known for being, you know, the best on the stick, but like when I get behind something emotionally and I really feel what I'm saying and I take the time to like absorb like what's going on and turn it into my own, like that's my best stuff. I'm stuttering and tripping over myself and because it's all, and that's what it was. Yeah. I remember like, oh, like what's going on?
But do you watch it back? Those promos you watch back, go, I shouldn't have stuttered. Oh,
we're always critiquing.
Yeah.
Like I know some guys that won't watch their own matches back for years even. I don't know if you're like that. I
have to study. I have to watch.
Yeah, I have to watch myself back because I know there's always things that I want to change. They're always small things.
It's funny you say that because the first time I won the World Heavyweight Championship, I still to this day haven't watched the match.
Really?
Because we're our own worst critics.
Yeah,
I remember how the feeling when I won it and the crowd's reaction. And you know, when I think about the match, in my mind it was perfect, right?
And, yeah. Yeah.
I'm a perfectionist, we all are. So if I watch it back, I'm gonna nitpick something.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I could have done this different, I should have done that. And I don't wanna have a tainted memory of that match at all, so yeah. I've never watched it back.
Yeah, but that's a pretty incredible thing of over, you know, almost two decades to have specific things that really stand out, your own career, but from others.
Right, oh yeah, for sure. There's so many, the guys that I came up with, like Jay, it's funny, I always, you know, when I'm talking about some of the best around, like every Canadian that I've worked with is awesome, you know? And I could try and go through the long list. Like even Bobby Roode I got to work with last year for the US title, another conversation for another day. But like he just reminded me of working with guys like Jay and Edge and like even Lance Storm back in the day. Like these guys like are amazing. I don't know what's in the water up there, but like but in 2011, and I'm going off topic here, but he and I had some killer matches, and he gives me, because he's like, oh, you don't know how good you are. It's like, I'm at my best when I'm working with guys that are as amazing as he is. And there's not many. So yeah. Like I'm hit or miss with my, but like with him, it was hit.
You don't give yourself enough credit.
Well, just, I'll never forget 2011 with Christian.
Yeah. Oh, thanks, man.
Never.
Rely,
so. Never. You know that though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I just love your smiles too, like hearing all of this praise for each other.
It's hard to sit here and keep a straight face if the cameras weren't on. Like, you know.
There'd be more ball busting.
Yeah, oh, 100%.
That's what I'm here for. I don't know about you.
But you're here for the ball busting?
I want to watch it, yeah.
That's good TV. But it's good to hear, and it's good to, you know, I'm a dad, I'm a husband now, and I've always kind of been known to wear my heart on my sleeve, so I don't mind talking about like what makes me feel good, what I remember, you know, what's, you know, the positive things in my life, and you know, both these guys I've had many positive moments with.
Yeah,
you know? Yeah, never forget them.
Well, with your kids now being of an age where they can start to understand everything, how do you describe to them the legacy of your career?
Well, it's a little different with me and my children. I have five children. My youngest will be three in the fall, so she has no idea what's going on. She's just now learning how to drop like knees on dad. So if I'm laying there like watching TV, like at any moment, I'm gonna catch a knee to the throat. my oldest daughter is 11, and she never really took to it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like she knows that dad's on TV and he wrestles, and it is what it is. It's what dad does for a living. It's his job. But my three sons, my stepsons, when I first met them, now they are huge wrestling fans. Mm-hmm. Like there's old pictures of them before I knew them, you know, wearing Jeff Hardy stuff and doing Halloween where they're all, and it's really great. Like they're huge fans. So when they found out that, you know, mom was dating Randy Orton, like, it's funny because for a while there, my wife, at the, Kim, didn't want to stooge off the fact that she was going to visit Randy Orton. So to all the cousins and friends, when she was leaving, I was Sandy Norton. So we're, so
very incognito.
Where are you going, Mom? Oh, it's got to go see Sandy. Sandy
Norton. What does she do when they're like, oh, let's see pics of him?
Yeah, no, right. Well, I think Sandy was a girl at the time, but it was. I think that's hilarious, but it is so funny because they used to think I was the coolest thing in the world, and now it's like I'm just stepdad Randy and got. Like, I tried to take my oldest to baseball practice. He was, 14, 13 at the time, maybe, freshman in high school. And I wanted to come in, and I wanted to, like, see him do some.
Yeah.
And I'll be damned, and he's going to kill me if this makes it. He got teary-eyed and was like, you can't come in. You don't know these kids. You don't know. they're going to be, yeah. And I'm like, man, like, 2 years ago, you thought I was the man, you know? You know, not anymore.
But he's like, embarrassed.
Yeah. Wouldn't he be proud that his dad's Randy Orton? Kids would want autographs, pictures.
When your kids grow up, you'll see. You'll see.
Stealing their heat.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's the kids thing. It's a weird dynamic in my family, but in my house. But I wouldn't change it. Wouldn't change any of it for the world.
Does your daughter know?
It's funny because we have these action figures, and she knows the Edge and Christian one. She'll see, you know, Uncle Adam, and then Daddy, you know, and then she'll play with the action figures. She hasn't figured out yet why I have these action figures, right?
Dad.
Yeah, why is there a doll? So, one time we were in like Walmart or something, and we're going down the toy aisle, and there I was sitting on the thing, and she's looking at it and then looking at me, like, Daddy, why are you on the shelf? Like, she couldn't figure out why there's like an action figure. Yeah,
elf on the shelf.
Yeah.
Hey, Dad.
Incredible.
But then, you know, I happened to be watching something on my phone. There was a clip of a match or something, and I was watching it, and she came up, and I just turned it and showed it to her. She's five. She's going to be six in October. And she looked at it, and she's like, Daddy, why are you jumping around like that? And then, like, she heard, like, the you know, the grunting and all stuff, and all of a sudden she started going, and then she runs out of the room, and I hear, like, the door open for the garage, so I go out, and I'm like, what is she doing out in the garage? She comes back in, she put her bike knee pads and elbow pads on, and told me to lay down on the ground. And then she jumped on me and started trying to wrestle.
Yeah.
And now I'm like, okay. Maybe we just we stop this now. Get your knee pads off. You know, we need to just cut this out real quick.
You loved every minute of it.
I did. Yeah. You know, she's an active little girl.
Yeah.
I think she is going to be a performer of some sort.
That's awesome.
And we'll show her again when she can really figure out what it is. But that was kind of her first taste of it. Yeah.
Oh wow.
That's pretty cool. Incredible.
Yeah, the whole action figure thing, I still don't, you know, sometimes, you know, like we're like everybody else. You gotta go get some toiletries for an overseas tour. So you go to Walgreens and there's that little toy aisle and you're like, oh, you know, let me just go check on that. And it's like,
I'm not on sale, there's not a bunch of me.
Yeah, they only have two and one of them's me. Like, sweet. You know, like, and you never get over it. Maybe some guys do, but like how could you?
You can't help, like, if you're at Target or Walmart to walk out. Toy aisle, and you look at look over and you go, well, let me see who we got today.
What about when you've been to that Target, Walmart, or Toys R Us or whatever, but I bought my own doll before at the store and totally, like, the guy's like, really? You know? And it's
I asked on the internet, like, does anyone know how many, like, I wanted all my action figures, and I was like, does anyone have a list? Is there a list anywhere? I asked Ryder, because Ryder is the guy. Yeah. He's like, there is no list, bro. There's exclusive ones for just these places. You'll never get all of them. And then I asked I saw some guy from Ringside Collectibles. He was like, yeah, we got them. I'll get you a list.
How many different dolls
do you have? There's like 100.
What? What?
Yeah. Isn't that crazy?
That's and they do crazy. All
I remember my first
era,
one with Jack Specific, and it was like, I couldn't believe I had my own toy.
Jack Specific. Yeah.
Remember those days?
Yeah. Well, the funny thing is I'm known for not getting new gear. Like, you always have a different...
Yeah, always. Skate.
So, and finally, I was with my wife at a signing in Vegas, and there was like a Mattel person there doing some stuff, and she went over and she's like, hey, you know, my husband never has new dolls coming out. You know,
I love that she went over there.
Oh, my,
I love it.
Oh, yeah, she's like, you know, and you know she was. Yeah. And they're like, well, if he changed his gear. So I was about, you know, 17, 18 years into the business before I realized that, oh, to get a new action figure, I got to change my
look. How do you think Rey Mysterio has 45 million different action figures?
He's on another level.
Oh, another level of just gear.
Yeah. It's amazing. Oh, my God.
Sometimes you might change gear in the mid-match. So is that something that you've considered now, is changing your gear specifically to have a new action figure come out?
I have started to do that. If you, like at Mania, I had neon green and black. When I was younger, I do like the neon orange and the neon blue and the purple. And I'm too old for that. I feel I'm not wearing a lot.
Yeah.
And it's like when I was younger, it was like, you know, yeah, now it's like, oh, I feel naked out there. You know, and I'm starting to get the, you know, I like to drink beer, so it's like I'm starting to get the, you know what I mean? Like, you know who the smartest in this business is? Roman Reigns.
I was going to say, the best.
Doesn't Roman, have to worry about anything.
Roman, all he has to do is train shoulders.
And, shoulders, you know, arms.
Yeah,
that's it.
Yeah.
That's like when you wore a puffy shirt in the Brood, all I had to do was cable crossovers because you only saw
striations in the... Oh, God, he's one of the smart... And then Kevin Owens, I don't know what's going on there, but for some... For some reason, he's smart too. I don't know what he's got on who, but he must.
So I had shorts on when I first started in WWE. I would wear shorts. I was like, I don't want to look like the quote-unquote quintessential wrestler.
Yeah.
I wore trunks one time, and it was to trick everyone. I had a mask on, and I was trying to trick everyone to gain a contract with WWE because I got fired the week before. So I was trying to win a contract on a pole match. So I came out as a Calgary Kid.
Right.
Wore trunks for the first time. Took off the mask, like held the contract up, got back. Vince calls me over, goes, you've got great legs, kid. You gotta wear trunks from now on. And I went, Oh no.
It's tough.
And from then on, I wear trunks.
Yeah. Did you ever wear pants?
I just wore shorts that went all the way down.
Okay, I must be thinking of someone else. I feel like some guy, like I want to do the full, wow, we're off topic. I want to do like the full, you know, legs, but like I don't have an ass. Mm-hmm. So like but I got the big quads. So like you got to work with what you got, you know what I'm saying? So I have the cut of my trunks accentuate my quads, and then it kind of hides my ass. I got the Orton on the back, and that little tribal thing kind of like just hides everything. And it's like, I had a pair made to see what I'd look like in them. And it's like, man, it was like not flattering at all. My wife was like, nope, you got to stay with the trunks.
Dang.
Yeah, I got to get Roman's guy to make me a bulletproof vest or whatever the he wears. I'm sorry I keep cursing.
No, not at all. They'll just bleep it.
Okay.
Be good.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
All right.
We are very off topic, but this has been thoroughly entertaining.
Yeah.
Very interesting beginnings for the Intercontinental Championship, and now I think it's over 80 different superstars have held the title.
That's it? Like, I thought there would be more.
Yeah.
Well, for me, you know, the Intercontinental Championship, like I said, as a kid, I wanted to be the Intercontinental Champion. Mm-hmm. Like, I wanted that. So to be able to hold that title on more than one occasion, and knowing what it meant to my career, now being retired, it excites me when I see the young guys get a chance, and you can see that look in their eyes when they win it. It means something to them, and so to me, that's pretty special. And that just shows you what the Intercontinental Championship means to this industry.
Yeah, I hope that the kids growing up now have the same feeling that we have about the IC title. You know, it's like you never know which title they like as children. Like, 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds, 12, 13, however old they are, like, I wonder what title they will literally, when they grow up and become a WWE superstar, which title is the one that they go, oh my God, I can't believe I got this. Because that was the Intercontinental title to me. So hopefully they have the same feeling.
That's a hell of a goal to try to make those children feel the same way about that belt. That you know, you felt as a kid, you know, and to inspire you. And then, you know, one day, you know, they'll be in the ring working with you, telling you the same. You're saying, like, oh my God, I can't believe you. When I was six, you were there. Now I'm here with you and I'm beating you for the strap. And, you know, and that it's just like total for full circle. So much in this business, it comes back around, and it's very special to be a part of it.
Yeah. Well, I know specifically, since you've talked about some of your goals of wanting to be the longest reigning Intercontinental Champion ever, do you hope to hold that title once again?
Yeah, I feel like what's happened to it before is happening to it again. Mm. So if I need to step in and take the IC title and make it something again, then I'll do that.
Well, maybe I'll get my win back on you, because I'm just saying this, throwing this out there.
Oh.
I'm technically still the number one contender for the Intercontinental Championship. Because I was injured in a match where I won, where I became the number one contender, and then I never wrestled again. So technically, you watch your back if you get it. I'm coming for my win.
One more match, bro.
Yeah. One more match.
Well, setting up challenges on this show, I can't wait to see where the Intercontinental title goes from here. Thank you guys so much for joining us for this panel today.
Thank
it's been an absolute pleasure.
Got it. Likewise.